Okay, so let us start. So last time we talked about two different type of number systems. One is a fixed point number and the other one is a floating point number, right? So we see that in fixed point numbers, you have a restriction over the number of digits you can have for the fractional part of the number. In the floating point, first thing, you have to write the number as a fraction times exponent of a base, and then you will have a restriction over the number of digits you can have on the fraction part, right? So those are the differences between fixed point number and floating point number, right? So to start with, let us do an exercise on the property of floating point numbers. And so I will write this as an exercise. So let us say this x, which is obviously written in the form f times be, right? So where f is obviously a fraction, a minus 1, a minus 2, all the way up to a minus t base b, and it can be plus or minus. So this is the floating point number, right? So we want to show that first, okay, so let x be a given fixed point number, floating point number, sorry. Then we want to show that this floating point number, absolute value of the fraction in this floating point number lies in between 1 upon b, which is the base, and 1. And hence, we are going to show that the exponent in the floating point number satisfies an equation which is, or the value for the exponent is 1 plus the integer part of the natural log, sorry, the log of x with base b, right? So a, the square bracket a, we denote it for integer part of a, right? Say for example, if I say 2.341, right? So integer part of this is 2. Right, so you have to be, you should be familiar with this notation, right? Integer part of this, a fraction, right? So 2 point this is 2, right? So the integer which is smaller than this, right? So this is actually... Right, so what I mean by smaller than is the integer in front of the number, right? So you know that if you draw the number line, 2 is here, 3 is here, and your 2.341 is here. So you look for the integer right in front of that, right? So that is how you pick the integer part, right? So that is the definition of integer part, right? So now the problem is, when I give you 1.9 minus 1.9, right? And then when I ask you to find the integer part of that, you might think it is minus 2 or minus 1, right? So the question is whether this is minus 2 or minus 1, right? So you should clearly look like this. And so your 1 point, minus 1.9 is here. So clearly minus 1 is here and minus 2 is here, right? So the integer smaller than 1.9 and right in front of this is minus 2. Right? So this has to be minus 2, right? Not minus 1. Right? In plus values, positive values, when you look for the integer part, you can just take the integer part directly from the number, right? When you're looking for negative numbers, right? When you're looking for the integer part of those negative numbers, and you should be careful because negative numbers are going in the other direction, right? So negative 1 is bigger, negative 2 is smaller, right? So that is the difference. In negative, so you should be careful when you are picking the integer part of negative numbers as well, right? Later on, we are going to pick integer part of negative numbers also, right? So you should be careful with that, right? How to pick the integer part. Positive numbers, fine. You can always pick it like that, right? So this is just an additional information about this integer part, right? Because in this coming sections, right, the section we are going to study today and the next class, we will be doing a lot of integer part things, right? So especially when you are handling negative numbers and integer part, you should be careful about this. So that's the additional information. Right, so now we will come back to this part. So first part, you want to show absolute value of this is less than 1 upon b and 1, right? So we will try to show that. The reason we put absolute value is because when you put absolute value, you don't need to worry about plus or minus, right? Otherwise, you have to worry about plus or minus. So in order to avoid that, we will use absolute value. Right. So here is the point. You all know that absolute value of f is this. Right, so this is clear. Right, when you put absolute value, you lose plus or minus. Right, so you can write this in a polynomial form. Right, so a minus 1, b to the power minus 1, plus a minus 2, b to the power minus 2, plus a minus t, b to the power minus t. Right? So you can write it like that. Right. Okay. Also, you should be aware of the possible values for the digits. Right? So you should know this. Right, so in floating point representation, for any polynomial representation or any representation of numbers, right, the digits in that representation should be between 0 and 1 less than the base. Right, so if it is base 10, it will be the numbers between 0, 1, 2 up to 9. If it is base 1, the numbers are minus 1, 0 and 1. If it is base 4, it will be 0, 1, 2, 3, 3 only, right? So this is one information. And because of the floating point representation, you know that this cannot be 0. If this is 0, then you move the decimal to the other place and make the exponent higher. So always you make sure that this term is non-zero. So this is clearly non-zero. So the smallest possible value you can have for a minus 1 is 1, right? So that is understandable for you now. Right? So based on this, we are going to see the exercise. We are going to see how we can get through with the exercise. Right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do this. Let me multiply absolute value of f by b to the power t, right? So if I do that, you can see that I will get this, right? So I have a polynomial representation, so I can use that. B to the power t minus 1 plus a minus 2, b to the power t minus 2 plus a minus t, b to the power 0, right? So when you multiply this by t, b to the power t on both sides, you get this polynomial representation, right? So this is with a polynomial with all positive exponents now, right? So this is an integer now. This becomes an integer. But you know that all a minus i's are between 0, right, larger than 0. So the smallest possible value for a minus 2, a minus 3, a minus 4 is 0, right? So the smallest value for a minus 2, a minus 3 up to a minus t is 0. And smallest value for a minus 1 is 1. So we will put the smallest values. So when you put the smallest values, you know, this is less or equal to 1 times b to the power t minus 1 plus 0 times b to the power t minus 2 plus all the way up to 0 times b to the power 0. Right? So when you put the smallest values, you get greater or equal. Right? So this is clearly b to the power t minus 1. So you all know that it is absolute value of f of bt is greater or equal to b to the power t minus 1. Right, so let me write that down. Let me name this as equation 1. Now I have to look for other side of inequality, because you know that you are looking for two side inequalities, right? So you are looking for two side inequality, so you have to look for other side inequality. Again, you look for the same thing, which is a minus 1 b to the power t minus 1 plus 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 a minus t, right? So b to the power not is 1, so I can drop that. Okay, right. So now, what is the largest value you can have for a minus 1, a minus 2 and a minus t, right? The largest value is b minus 1, right? So because you know, if it is 10, the largest value is 9. If it is 2, base is 2, the largest value is 1. If it is 4, the largest value is 3. So if the base is b, then the largest value is b minus 1. So this largest value is b minus 1, b to the power t minus 1 plus b minus 1. Right? So you can take out this. This is b minus 1 to the power b to the power t minus 1 plus b to the power t minus 2 plus all the way up to 1. Correct? Right. So if you factor out b minus 1, which is a common factor in all the terms, so when you factor out, you get b to the power t minus 1 plus b to the power t minus 2 and all the way up to b minus 1. So now if you simplify that, you will get this is b to the power t minus 1. Right, so this is equal to b to the power t minus 1, right? So you multiply by b and multiply by minus 1 and cancel the like terms. You will end up with b to the power t minus 1. Right. So this is clearly strictly less than b to the power t. Right? B to the power t minus 1 is obviously strictly less than b to the power t. Right? Because if you think 500 minus 1 is obviously less than, strictly less than 500, because it is 499 and the other one is 500. So that's not a big thing. So now you can write the second equation. F b to the power t is finally, you have a strict less than b to the power t. Let me name that as a second equation. Okay. Right, so then if you combine 1 and 2, right, so if you combine 1 and 2, you get b to the power t minus 1 is less than or equal to absolute value of f b to the power t, right, so 1 and 2 together gives you, this is less than b to the power t. Right? So now if you divide both sides by b to the power t, you get this. And so this implies 1 upon b is less or equal to absolute value of f is less than 1. And so this is what they ask you to show in the first part. Okay? Second part is, we want to get the other results, right? So we want to get x. So if you want to get x, you know you have to have b to the power e there, right? So for the second part, now you multiply this both sides by b to the power e. So b to the power e times 1 upon b is less or equal to absolute value of f times b to the power e is less than b to the power e, right? So now for the second part, you multiply the inequality by b to the power e on both sides, right? So when you do that, you get b to the power e minus 1 is less or equal to, now you know this one is x, absolute value of x, because x is f b to the power e, so absolute value of x is absolute value of f b to the power e is less than b to the power e, right? So from this we can get to the other results, right? But before going that, I will give you a bonus information here, right? From this, right? So if you put this, right, so you will get two results. If you get rid of absolute value, right, so if you remove the absolute value, if x is plus x, it is fine, you will get this inequality. The other value for x is minus x. If you put minus x, then when you multiply every side by minus, you get this inequality. So this gives you an interval for x. So this says x belongs to closed interval b e minus 1 open at b e, or open at negative b e comma closed at b e minus 1. Right, so this says x belongs to this interval or x belongs to that interval, right? So this is a bonus information. And so not what we are looking for, but from this inequality, you can say that x, if it is, if x is positive, then it belongs to this interval. If x is a negative number, then it belongs to this interval. Right. So you have a place for the floating point number. Right. So if x is a floating point number, then you can locate it depending on whether it is plus or minus. Right. So now we will go back to what we are looking for. Right. The value of the exponent e. So we want to get that. Okay, so we will use the inequality again, this one, right? So you have this x to the power, absolute value of x lies in between b e minus 1 and b e, right? So you take the natural log of b on both sides of the inequality. Okay, so you get this. So this means e minus 1 right, so what you have is e minus 1 is less or equal to log of x, b base b log of x less or equal to e, right? So then obviously you can see that e minus 1 is an integer, e is an integer, so you can see that this is a real number, positive real number, lies in between two successive integers, something like 2.31 lies in between 2 and 3, right? Or 5.75 lies in between 5 and 6. So clearly the integer part of this is this. Right, so based on the explanation I gave you for integer part of a real number, right, so you can say that the integer part of log of x base b is e minus 1. So if you move 1 to the other side, you will get e is equal to 1 plus integer part of log b of x. Okay. Right, so this is a bonus information or a property of a floating point number, right? So if you are given a floating point number, then you have some information regarding the floating point numbers, right? So this exponent and the range of that floating point number or the location of the floating point number can be determined by this. Results. Right, now what we are going to do is to, if you are given a real number, right, you have no restriction. If you are talking about a real number, then you have no restrictions over how many digits you can have in that number. And so you can have 5 digits, you can have 50 digits, you can have 500 digits, you can have 10,000 digits, it doesn't matter. Right, so you can have 1 digit, right? So there is no restriction in real numbers over how many digits you can use in a real number, right? So you can have infinite digits, right? Say for example, if you are given 1/6, right? So it is going to be 1/3. If you are given 1/3, you are going to have 0.333333333. And it will continue up to infinity, right? So there are numbers like that, right? But if you are given 1/8, then you have a limited value, right? 0.125. So like that, you can have different number of digits in a real number. But floating point number and fixed point number has limited number of digits in the fractional part, right? So you can have only limited number of digits. So in that case, you may have to cut down certain digits to locate a real number into a floating point number or a fixed point number, right? So basically, if you want to enter a number inside a machine which is using floating point number system or fixed point number system, then the machine may have to cut down certain digits in order to do the arithmetic, right? So cutting down those digits obviously going to modify the number, right? So it is going to create error, right? And then first, what we are going to do is we are going to see how the machine is going to cut down the digits, unnecessary digits, right? Or the digits which it cannot handle. And then we are going to see what kind of error that might occur and how we can estimate the error, right? So that is what we are going to do now. Right, so Okay, so if you want to insert a certain real number into a machine which uses fixed point numbers or floating point numbers, then the machine have to cut down or axe down certain unnecessary digits, right? So the excess digits. So that chopping down part is being done by two different ways. One is rounding and the other one is chopping. You have seen this already in your O levels, right? So here we are going to see it in a machine perspective, right? So for example, right, so if you are given a number like this, right, so 1.34, right, so x is this number, right? So suppose you can have only four decimal places, right? So if you can have only this much of digits in the computer, then you have to drop down these 781 there, right? So you know that usually what you do is you convert it into 1.3457, right? Because after 6, there is a number which is larger than or equal to 5, half of the base. So you add one more to that and say it is approximately equal to, right? So you can say x is approximately equal to this. Or you can just drop the digits and say x is approximately equal to 1.3456. Both are possible, right? So there is no way that this one is right and that one is wrong, or that one is right is this one is wrong, right? So depending on what kind of method you are using, you may ended up with an approximation 1.3457. Or you can have approximation 1.3456. So obviously both are not correct values. Right? Correct value is given on the top. Right? So these are approximated values. This can be done in both ways. Right? So this way or that way. So this way is called rounding. Right? So you round the last digit. Right? Depending on what kind of digits you are dropping off, you round off the last digit, right? So this one, you don't worry about what kind of digits you are dropping off, right? You just cut after that place. So this process is called chopping. Right? So this is called chopping. So what we are going to do now is we are going to see how chopping and rounding is being done on the two types of number systems, right? So floating point number system works differently, fixed point number system work differently. So rounding in floating point may work differently, chopping in floating point work differently, rounding in fixed point work differently, fixed point works differently. So we are going to see all four cases one by one, right? So how we are doing chopping in a fixed point, how we are doing rounding in a fixed point, how we are doing this and that, right? So we are going to see all of them one by one. So there will be four cases. I will start with the first case. Right, rounding onto a fixed point integer, right? So if f is a given real number, right, so let's say now alpha. Right, so alpha be a given real number, right? So we want to find a rounded value of alpha in fi of bt, right? So that is our goal, right? So okay, so this is the conclusion we can get from the property of the fixed point numbers, right? So because of the uniform spacing you have on the fixed point numbers, we see this uniform spacing, right? So we proved that at the beginning, right? So every fixed point set of numbers has a uniform spacing b to the power minus t. So because of that property, for any given alpha, you can find a fixed point number in that set. I name it as Fi of alpha, right? Such that Fi of alpha lies in between alpha minus half bt and alpha plus half bt, right? So let me show you in a picture how this is happening. Okay, so let's draw the line. This is the line of fixed point integers of BT, right? So there will be fixed point integers, right? So there is a fixed point integer. There will be another fixed point integer. There will be another fixed point integer. And the length or distance between them is B to the power T, right? So you all know that this b to the power negative t is the distance between those two numbers, right? So that is what we studied earlier. So now you are throwing in an alpha, right? Alpha is a real number. So it's not necessarily a fixed point number. So if you put an alpha, it will be fall somewhere in this line, right? So suppose that is falling here. Alpha, right? So alpha here. So if the alpha is in the center, right, if you go half of the b minus t this way, you will cross, right? So say suppose I put this in the center, so let me put this little away, right? So let me put alpha here, right? So now this is smaller than, this space is smaller than b to the power minus t, half of b to the power minus t, right? So this space is smaller than half of b to the power minus t. You know that, right? Because you put alpha close here. So if you go from alpha, if you go in this way, you go half b to the power minus t. And in this way, you go half b to the power minus t. So you go alpha plus half b to the power t and alpha minus half b to the power t on both sides. Right? So if you go this way or that way, definitely on one side, you will cross a fixed point number, right? So in this case, if you go this way down, you will cross a fixed point number. But on this way, you will not cross a fixed point number, right? Similarly, if I put alpha close here, right? So then if I go half b to the power minus t here, I will cross that number, right? So if I go other way around, I will not cross the number, right? So if I go here, I will not cross the number. So I cannot cross the number. So anyways, if you go half of the uniform spacing left and right of alpha, definitely you will cross at least one fixed point number. And that is what written here, right? So if you go half of the uniform spacing on the left and right of alpha, you will hit onto at least one fixed point number. And that fixed point number, we name it as Fi of alpha, and this is this, right? So we call this right. So we call this as the rounded value of the real number alpha in the fixed point integers, fixed point number sets, right? Okay. So now let's see the formula for this Fi of alpha, right? So we know that there is an Fi of alpha, but we need to get a formula. This is an inequality. From this inequality, let us get the formula for Fi of alpha. That is not a big thing, right? So if you have the inequality, you can use the thing, right? So here is the inequality. So I don't write it again. You know the inequality, right? So b to the power minus t. Right? So when you multiply this inequality by b to the power t, right? So from this, I am writing here, right? So alpha b to the power t minus half is less than Fi of alpha b to the power t less than alpha b to the power t plus half, right? So from this, we have this, right? Right, so you have this. You multiply by b to the power t. So now you take this first and write it down. So Fi of alpha bt is less than alpha b to the power t plus half, right? Now you take this inequality, right? So alpha b to the power t minus half is less than Fi of alpha bt, right? What I do is I add one with this. And so from the first two terms in the inequality, I add one on both sides. So what I get is this, right? So let me name this as equation one. And here I have alpha b to the power t plus half is less than Fi of alpha b to the power t plus 1. And so I name this as equation 2. And so if I combine equation 1 and equation 2, I will get a result. And so if I combine equation 1 and equation 2, Fi of alpha b to the power t is one of them is less or equal. Right? So which one is less or equal? Plus half. Yeah, so let me put this as less or equal. Right, so less or equal alpha b to the power t plus half less than Fi of alpha b to the power t plus 1. Okay, so I combine inequality 1 and inequality 2, I get this. But you know, This is an integer. Fi is a fixed point number with t digits in the fraction. You multiply by bt, so that is an integer. And this one is the next integer. This is a real number. A real number lies in between two successive integers. So integer part of the real number is this. Right, so integer part of that number is this. Right. So from this, you can write what is the formula for Fi of alpha. That is b to the power negative t times integer part of alpha b to the power t plus 1/2. Right. So if alpha is given, right, you can always write down the rounded value of that number in fixed point value. Right? So this is an important thing. You have to be careful, right? So let me write the remark here. Half Right, so half means you should write half as the base in the B, right? Say for example, right, in base 10, right, you write 0.5, right? So instead of half, if you are working on base 10, you should write 0.5, right? In base 2, you will write 0.1, right? You cannot write 1 upon 2 or 0.5, right? So in base 2, it should be 0.1, right? Similarly, in base 4, it will be a different value. In base 8, it will be a different value. In base 16, it will be a different value, right? So depending on the base, so this half is a general half in terms of base B, right? So depending on what base you are working on, you may need to change this to 0.5, 0.1 or some other numbers, right? So in the next class, I will do an example on this. While doing the example, I will tell you, I will show you how you change the half into the certain base, right? So I will stop here and then we will continue in the next class.